kids and soul?
It's my fourth year at Meadowbrook, my 12th year teaching. The majority of my experience has been in, I think, 11 years in third grade, with some mixed classroom levels in there.
So we've got a lot of third grade experience between the two of us. And so we're going to talk with you tonight about what it looks like to have a growth mindset in third grade and as well as across the grades. Because this isn't just a third grade thing, this is hopefully a life thing.
Yeah.
And a lot of the things they can apply at home.
Absolutely.
So, one thing that kind of encompasses one of the themes that we have in third grade is a make something activity. So I've done this a couple times, and I think some of the other teammates have. We ask you to imagine something you could make with everyday materials. Think about what it would look like. Something that you would like.
Thinking about it, yeah.
Imagine what it looks like, visualize, and then we're going to ask you to create it with two materials we give you.
So we're going to come around and give you a piece of tin foil and a couple of pipe cleaners, and your job is to make what you imagine. Okay? Yes, they're imagining now.
Oh, I'm getting right kind of coming.
Maybe another moment or two to kind of finish your creation.
So you are a lot more quiet than the children. But I can tell you what I usually write down or write down on the iPad what the kids are saying and then put it up. But some of the nonverbal things we noticed was there's some nervous giggling. There's a lot of kind of looking around, seeing what others are doing.
I heard an oh my.
Oh my. What are some things you were thinking about when we gave you? You can be honest. Well, they're amazing. They're quite crazy.
I didn't think of that. Something I was thinking. Oh, I saw that.
Once I started, I was thinking, oh, why wasn't I thinking? Why didn't I imagine something else? This one is hard.
I don't know why I start thinking about stacking cups at home. And then all I could think of was, like, was I trying to build a shelter? And so I built a shelter. Needed more framework, like think of something that you want to build, like, yeah, and not that it was wrong.
No.
Yeah.
So what usually happens with third graders when we do this activity with them is that they are very vocal, and we hear lots of things like, I can't do this, this is dumb, I can't make anything, I don't like it.
This isn't what I wanted to. Some will even, it's a struggle for some kids, and they just don't want to do it anymore because it doesn't look like what's in their head. Mm-hmm. So then afterwards we talk about how this activity wasn't necessarily about what we made, it's about the words we were saying to ourselves. And how we were uncomfortable, and how for some people that was a struggle. And then what kind of mindset is that? And then if the words that you said to yourself, you can't do that, that's wrong, this is bad, oh, I heard this is bad sometimes, mm-hmm. or this is dumb, or I don't know what I'm doing.
Or mine's ugly.
Yeah, mine's ugly. Would you ever say that to a friend? Would you ever say that to a peer? If you saw somebody else's work, would you say that? No, you'd cheer them on. You'd be like, oh, don't worry, you can do it, let's see how we can change it. So we talk about, well, why would you say that to yourself? You're just as valuable. Mm-hmm. So we really talk about this growth mindset and our self-talk, and it's not what we want, but what can we do? Mm-hmm. You know, it's not looking exactly like what's in your brain, but you still have to have some grit, figure out what you can do, and be kind to yourself. Mm-hmm. So that that's very interesting, because every class kind of acts different.
Absolutely. So when you see the word mistake, let's take a moment of silence. What do you think of when you think of the word mistake? So what does the word mistake kind of invoke in you?
Oh, I just need to do that.
Wrongs.
Yeah.
Something's wrong.
Yeah.
Something you can learn from.
Say that again?
Something you can learn from.
To learn from.
A lot of kids will say it's uncomfortable. They're scared to say anything. Mm-hmm. They're, even if they think they're right, they still don't know if it's a mistake.
That's not a good...
We can do this.
We should have rehearsed. So then we hand out the brain and we'll say, well, it can be uncomfortable. Sometimes I'll have them write how they feel on this instead so that they don't have to share it loud. And so, you know, when you make a mistake, how's it make your brain feel? You're like, oh, so I have them crumple it up. So crumple up your brain.
Crumple your brain.
Oh. Yeah. So then I'm going to have the students uncrumple it. Sometimes they do a snowball and they go get something else. Then we would have the kids, and we didn't bring enough pencils or markers, but we would have them with a pencil or marker draw along all the creases, connecting all those creases. And then we would say, well, when you do make a mistake, that's what happens in your brain. And we'll watch Joy. When you make a mistake, that's what happens, the connections happen.
Shy away from challenging schoolwork and get discouraged quickly when they make mistakes. These students are at a significant disadvantage in school and in life more generally because they end up avoiding the most difficult work, which also tends to be the most productive. Let's hear more about the importance of mistakes from Stanford professor Joe Bowler.
So recently, a New York Times columnist, Peter Sims, wrote a really compelling piece about the critical role of mistakes in innovation and design thinking. And he analyzed the differences between more and less successful entrepreneurs, and he found that the successful ones basically make more mistakes. And they learn from those mistakes, and that learning set them on the path to huge success. But another New York Times columnist and best-selling author of the book Better by Mistake, Alina Tugend, has written, correctly in my view, that we are raising a generation of children who are terrified of blundering, of failing, of even sitting with the discomfort of not knowing something for a few minutes. So what we're finding from research is that when students make a mistake, and I'm thinking of this as a kind of core mistake, not an error, such as a numerical slip, but when they make a mistake about an idea in math, two sparks happen. First, when they make the mistake, and then again, when they think about the mistake. And that doesn't happen when people get work correct. So this was stunning to me. And the reason is, it turns out that making mistakes is the most useful thing to be doing. The very most useful thing in maths. But students often feel really bad, crushed even, if they make a mistake in maths. They think it means that they're not a maths person. But it turns out it's really the most useful thing they can be doing.
So that, I mean, she kind of centered it around math, but it applies to all of our learning and in life. I mean, we want kids to struggle through that healthy struggle, sitting there looking at something and realizing it's not what you want. It's very upsetting sometimes. And so we really want to facilitate and support them through that and help them realize that mistakes make your brain grow. Mistakes are good. That's how you know you're learning. Kind of like in math also, with that fixed mindset instead of a growth mindset, the kids will be like, I'm just bad at math. And then they're not willing to make those mistakes or willing to take a risk or that effort. So we really worked hard this year and in years past on getting rid of that stigma of who's working with what groups and I made a mistake, so that means I'm not smart or, yeah.
And we can also apply this growth mindset as well into non-academic areas. Like if your child forgets their homework, okay, they're not a bad person, they just forgot. So instead of mom and dad coming to swoop in and save the day by delivering the homework, we let the child be a little bit uncomfortable and learn from that, and then tomorrow they bring it. We know when a child tells us, you know, I forgot my homework, I forgot my planner, I forgot my folder. Okay, bring it tomorrow. I bet you'll remember tomorrow. And that's just an easy, gentle way for them to realize that making a mistake, like forgetting something, is okay. It happens to all of us, and we can learn from it, and we can move on from it. Now, of course, if it ends up being habitual, then we've got other issues that we're working with. But an occasional forget once in a while is not a big deal, and it does not need to crush us. And that's what we've seen historically, is kids getting crushed from forgetting something or making a mistake. And so we're trying to help them move beyond that.
So that was a picture of one of the brains that we did. And then this is James Dyson, and we are in our engineering unit right now. So this is one of the stories we showed, and this also was focused on through the Bakken. Mm-hmm. Which, thank you.
As a field trip at Ethiopia,
yep. So one of the powerful things he said was, I made 5,127 prototypes of my vacuum before I got it right. And that was within 4 years, so we were like, that's 5,000. There were 5,126 failures, but I learned from each one. That's how I came up with the solution, so I don't mind failure. And even in our invention process right now, you see so many kids make it, and they're like, okay, I'm done. Like, well, have you tried this? You don't know if that'll work or not work. So really focusing on that. Improve. Let's try something new. Let's see what else will work.
Or that there's more than one way to be right.
Mm-hmm.
That there's not just one specific way to come to an answer. Even in math, when you have one particular numerical answer, there might be a variety of different ways to get there. And all of those ways are valid and okay.
And for some students, that's the challenge.
Mm-hmm.
To try to find a different way or try to explain what's happening in their brain.
Mm-hmm.
So there's all these different ways to challenge and help them through that healthy struggle. So we work hard to get rid of the stigma associated with struggling, mistakes, and needing help. We hopefully come to realize that mistakes help us. Healthy struggle helps you grow. And that there are real life consequences as well. That accountability, that responsibility, if they know that it affects them, it's relatable to them, then it's much more powerful and engaging to them.
If we think of, you know, we've always heard the phrase, practice makes perfect, which... There's, you know, perfection is very hard to achieve, and a lot of kids feel as though they need to be perfect, whether that's self-imposed or if it's imposed on them by people in their life or what they see in the media or whatever it might be. We really try to focus on practice makes progress, not perfect. And it's okay not to know the answer. It's okay to have that healthy struggle through things.
You won't believe how many times you guys are late for work, by the way. My mom didn't pack it in my backpack, my dad didn't tell me to do it, or those kinds of things. So that's what we're trying to do. We're really trying to help them have that accountability, that responsibility. If they realize they made the mistake or if they forgot something, they're learning from it. And they're becoming these citizens, which is kind of what third grade's about. I mean, you've learned how to school, you've learned the academic piece, you've learned this, and now we need to teach you how to be responsible for your learning.
Anybody have any questions about growth mindset?
I'm so happy about you.
Right. Well, thank you.
Well, you can keep your creations.
Yes, that's yours.
We can put them on display too.
A simple thing you can do with your kids is when they say, I'm not good at that, you can say, you're not good at that yet.
Oh.
The word yet is very powerful.
The power of yet. That's a, but one of our sayings is IDKY, I don't know yet.